Thanks, Maria. For those who do not believe in the silence, and if you want to talk, if you puede, we go to a place where we will not disturb those who have somehow decided to give the silence a chance. If you want to talk among yourselves and you don't want to do this 11 hour, please do it in some place where we will not disturb those who will give it a chance. But to be able to endure that silence and to actually profit from the silence, we beg for it as a grace. Kasi hindi natin ito kaya kung tayo lang. So hingin natin ito bilang biyaya ng katahimikan. Because in a retreat, nothing happens by accident. Especially the good things that happen. They don't happen by accident. Okay. So let's begin. The Society of Jesus filed a cause for beatification of Richie Fernando. Richie Fernando and I entered the same year together. You know Richie Fernando, he's a scholastic who was assigned in Cambodia, and in a tussle with somebody who was holding a grenade, this guy had run him up. In a tussle, the grenade left his hand, and Richie Fernando tried to protect the kids, and the grenade blasted, killing him, but saving all the others. Now, there was a motion to further his beatification in society. Now, filing a cause for beatification or canonization is a long, arduous, and expensive process, we realize. They gather volumes of information about the person, testimonies about the candidate. They open all his journals, read all his letters, all the books that are about him, or any other journals that may involve his name. So they also ask permission if they could open the journals of his friends wherever there were entries about Richie Fernando. And there were testimonies. Interviews were done. If friends of the person is, or the disciples are still alive, they're interviewed. Otherwise, documents related to him are opened and scoured, including testimonies where there are reports of miracles. And then they sent all of these files to Rome, where they will all be evaluated along with 1,000 other causes for sainthood or beatification. This high. So if it falls in the bottom of the files, then you'll have to wait a long time. So what I mean to say is it takes a lot of effort and people and a lot of cash for this cause to be officially canonized or beatified by Rome. If the candidate comes from a poor family or a poor religious congregation, the process will take even longer. If it even gets off the ground. If it even gets on top of the pile. So, there. That's the cost for beatification and canonization. There are, however, saints who will never be officially canonized by Rome. But they are saints to me. And anyway, I actually pray to them, and I know that they hear me, and I know that they protect me by their prayers, because I know they're so much closer to God right now, as they are, as souls, than I'll ever be in this life. Let me begin with Eric Rana. Eric Rana is a schoolmate of mine in grade school. We were not classmates then. He was fat, he walked with a limp, and he had a bum left hand, so he walked like this, in his fat. And he always carried a small black pocket. That was his trademark. He was effeminate. He was bullied, laughed at. But one thing that they could not doubt, he was a math whiz. And he would win all the math quiz bowls that put his bullies to shame. Then we became classmates in high school and we became best friends. We walked home almost every day. And in those walks, I learned he was a child out of wedlock. And his mom had kept him. But because he did not have any money, because the father ran away, the mom hired herself out as a kasambahay to a very strict and very abusive aunt. Para lang, meron siyang may gusto sa pag-aaral ni Eric, ng anak niya. So, it was very tough for Eric to see his mom being a kasambahay to an abusive aunt. But you can imagine how much Eric loved his mom. So he graduated from high school and college and high honors. And he eventually worked in SSS, got promoted, and he built a house in Tagum for mom, and supported her with love and devotion, and gave her everything that she needed. And he died at 48. Complications, diabetes, and kidney trouble. And I prayed to Eric during difficult times in my life. He was someone who knew me through and through, and I knew him through and through. With his hard but loving life, he was and is a saint for me. And I'm sure for his mom. But Eric will never become canonized yet. The second person is Gilgil, whom I call Saint Gilgil. The best lavandera and plantadora I've ever met. You know by the smell and by the ironing of your clothes that they were done with malasakit and with deep respect and even great honor. And Gilgil had been with us in Cebu for many years. And then after my third year there, my assignment there, I noticed that she was very haggard. She came to the kitchen to get some food. And I asked her, Jill, what's happening to you? Why are you so haggard? And she said, Nibalik ang akong cancer. Also, you had meron ka palang cancer, yes, Father. Remission lang ko for like 7 years. But all those 7 years, she would come to work. And she even said to me, alam mo, Father, kahit may chemotherapy ako, tatakbo ako sa ospital, tapos bago mag-kick in yung symptoms ng chemotherapy, yung after effects, maglalabang muna siya kasi ayaw niyang umuwi ng ulang cello. Tapos pag nag-kick in na, she would take a rest for like a week. And just had to feed her 5 children. Late pa. And she lived in the slums behind the school. Tapos ang sinabi niya sa akin would get me, and I will always remember her for this. Yeah. Alam mo ba, Father, kung bakit ako nagtagal ng 7 years na hindi bumabalik ang cancer? Dahil nagtagal pa ako ng mga gamit ng pahe. She thought there was power and glory from the clothes that she wore. She eventually died a few years ago, leaving her 5 small children behind, and they were distributed to their relatives. And since then, I have prayed to Jill during the tough moments in my priesthood. With her hard but loving life like Eric's, she was and is a saint for me, and I'm sure for her children too. But she will never be canonized. In San Jose Seminary, during the time of Kuya Mike, before the diaconate ordination, we would have the parents of the ordinance come together in a recollection the day before. And then this was told to us by the former rector, who told this story to us of his experience, that sharing the recollection in our Christology class, because we were discussing the Passion of Christ. So in the final sharing during the evening, in walked the parents and the ordinance, and nakita ng rector, yung isang tatay, putuli isang paa, mga crutches. And so he said, and so they were supposed to talk to each other during the sharing, the ordinance, to their friends and parents, to their children. And then sabi daw ng tatay, and I paraphrase because I could not remember exactly what he said. So, sabi daw ng tatay, ang dami namin dinanas ng nanay mo para makapagpadala ng kahit kaunti sa'yo. Mula sa init ng araw, hanggang sa gabi, pasa sa ulan, sa pagtintina ng balut. Magbabalut pala siya. Ang sakit ng katawan ng nanay mo sa paglalaba. Binasbasan lahat yon ng Panginoon dahil bukas anak, biyako pagbiyako ng anak. I've never met tatay. This story was only told to us by the rector at San Jose during Christology class discussing the passion of Christ. Talk about passion that saves. Now, I don't know if tatay is still alive, but he doesn't know how deeply affected I was by that story. Tatay and nanay must have been such saints to their son. They would be to me, but they would never be canonized. If God created the universe and the earth and all that is in it for us, how much more did He create other people for us? When God created Eve and Adam, when God created Eve from Adam's rib, the Genesis authors did not mean to make women subordinate to men and to galvanize that gender difference. Because if that were the logic, if women are subordinate to men because they were made from man's rib, then since Adam was created from dust, then men should be subordinate to dust. Rather, the message is that man and woman were created from one flesh by one creator who is greater than themselves. Therefore, because all of us are created by one creator from one source, that is love, our bond with God and for each other is primordial, primus ordinis, of the first order. Yes, we are created singly and very, very uniquely, but we were created with each other and for each other. Second, notice, my brothers, it is only after Adam and Eve are described as husband and wife, the Genesis author did not directly describe, did not directly say they're husband and wife, but they're described that way. Only after Adam and Eve are described as husband and wife that Yahweh commanded them to fill the earth and subdue it. And we may take that to mean that we were created first to be relational and only subsequently operational. Relational first, only subsequently operational. Now, I have noticed that there are many religious men and women who can be so operational than relational. Jesuits are masters of this, I confess. But I'm sure you see this in your communities too. People who are highly and effectively operational, efficient, accomplished, fantastic in administration, fundraising, building, etc. But they don't seem to have an identifiable, specifiable best friend. Or at least an identifiable, specifiable group of close friends, whether in community or outside. May mga ganon. And with Jesuits, there are highly intelligent, accomplished people who cannot do small talk. Hindi sila marunong mag-small conversation. May mga ganong eswita. They are always talking about what they read, from this or that book, or this or that author's ideas, their management concepts, their latest theories. Fascinating! Pero nakapagod. Kasi parang nagle-lecture sa pagkainan. May kiss pa mamaya pa rin. Whenever you go in conversation, there's no personal information, there's no report of feelings, there's no sentiments. Tapos English pa. And this is what we notice with religious who have stayed in power positions for too long. Lalo na yung may kaharian na, yung mga kingdoms. Sa tagal din na bilang boss, administrator, superior, they're so used to relating to subordinates rather than equal. So to get back to the point, we were created unique as individuals, but created to be with and for another. Whether we admit it or not, not, my dear brothers, whether we show it or not, we seek friendship. Whether we admit it or not, whether we show it or not, we yearn to be in relationship. We are wired for this. It is not a sin to desire relationship. And thank God, because God did give us people to relate with and live with. When Jesus began his ministry, what was his first move? It was to choose his circle of friends. And like the regular rabbis who would wait in the synagogue or their houses and be approached by students, Jesus got up and out of his way to relate and choose friends who would subsequently help him do his ministry. Relational first, and then operational. One of the best things about Jesus Christ was that he shared with his friends his saving ministry. Remember the 70 disciples who came rejoicing back after a mission? He shared with them power to cure diseases, forgive sins, and expel demons. After the mission, they all came rejoicing. They could not believe, and they were astounded that they too had salvific power. And a similar group of disciples today were sent to us. Your Erics, your Jiljils, your magbabalik tatays of our own lives. Who fed us? Who were the people in your life who made sure you did not go hungry? To what length did they go to make sure you don't go hungry? Who cooked your meals, packed your baon, bought you cake and ice cream on your birthday, or took you to Jollibee? Who were our healers? Who took care of you when you got sick? Who made sure you took your medicines when your family was short of money? Who helped buy medicines or pay the hospital bills? Today, to whom do you owe the care that you receive, the comfort, the freedom from pain? When I was growing up, whenever I had my asthma attacks, hindi pa na-invento yung nebulizer for me. My dad would stay up all night beside me to rub my chest and my back, because that was the only way that I could get some sleep when I had a hard time breathing. And then mom would serve my favorite breakfast. Even if she could not cook, she would herself fry Spam and egg and serve it to me for breakfast. If there was one thing that was good about having an asthma attack, it was the breakfast in bed, cooked by my mom, who never cooked the same thing. I do not like the smell of Vicks Vapor-Rub, which dad always applied on our chest and our back when we had a sign of cold. But it worked. The next day we were fine. And who could forget Jinky, our kasambahay? When I had my asthma attack again, she comes serving my mom's breakfast, and she asks in Ilongga, "Kuya, niluwala ka ba sa fasting?" I said, man. Nga hao, bakit? Kay nag-fast man ko para sa imo, para mahil ka.
Sana ko.
Who taught us? Who taught you your first prayers? Aside from your parents. Who accompanied you to Mass? Who was your favorite teacher when you were growing up and why? Who taught you to sing and play the piano? My mom and dad sent me to piano school because I could not play sports. It's asthmatic again. So, who exercised us? Who set you straight when you started losing your weight? Who helped you name your demons and bravely call them out for you to confront them? Who understood your sins and still loved you in spite of yourself? And lastly, who loved us? Who are the people from whom you felt true and deep love? Where are they now? What would you want to tell them if they were sitting beside you today and holding your hand? There was an OMI priest in my retreat. He said he heard God singing to him, "Mahal kita, pagkat mahal kita." Iniisip nila ay hindi mahalaga. Mahal kita maging isinukat aman. We didn't have a piano because we were not very rich, but mom and dad sent me to piano school. And one day, I saw my dad talking with a strange man. I say strange because that day, hindi pa naman usong law sleeves. And he was talking to a man who was wearing law sleeves, and they were discussing very intently at table, and I kind of wonder what it was. After like 2 weeks or so, the man was back, and then they were doing something at table. I could not contain my curiosity any longer, so I came near them. And I said, "Dad, what are you doing?" And they were counting barila. I said, Dad, what, are you, what what's all this? And we just quietly picked up a brochure and they piligan. And when I opened the brochure, it was a brochure of pianos. I can remember like it was yesterday. I realized they were buying me a piano with barila. Maybe because it was cheaper than installment. And I made sure, my dear brothers, I remember like it was yesterday, I chose the cheapest piano. How much was the cheapest piano then, which was really expensive? 12,000 pesos. My bad piano. Could God have saved us, my dear brothers, while staying in heaven? Or becoming a disembodied angel? Or remaining an invisible spirit? Yes. He could save the world from remote control, sure. But that he chose to be incarnated as a human being tells us that being human like us is an honorable reality, a godly reality, a saving reality. In good people in our lives, God continues to incarnate Jesus, who also keeps sharing his powers with them so we may continue to have life and have it more abundantly. In being human in Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ sharing his power of salvation, he continues that to the people who have saved us every day. I do not know if you know Dr. Oz. He's a friend of Homer's. Before he ran for the Republican Party, he was very popular. But in one interview that he had with Oprah, he's a heart surgeon, a very well-known heart surgeon. He realized from practice that most of the people who died on the table during surgery for the heart were people who did not have anyone to wake up to. And marami nun sa US, diba? Mga parang walang relatives or walang friends. Now, learning his lesson, now he makes sure that before someone checks in for surgery, he makes sure that they wake up to at least a long of a friend, an acquaintance. Basta pag-gising nila after the surgery or while before the surgery, alam nila na may kakagistan silang tao na nandyan. Unless the person has that, Dr. Mehmet Oz will try all his best to look for that person so that this person doesn't die at all. Because he has got to give them a reason to keep alive. When they know there's someone the heart can still beat for, the heart keeps beating. So, think of people and be grateful for God's grace, embodied and incarnated in the people down our life history who have done us well, who have loved us. My dear brothers, I respectfully remind you, our history is the history of salvation. Salvation history is not the history above history, human history. Salvation history happens within our human history through people who have saved us through the years. When was the last time that you talked to your saint? Whether it's your mom or your dad or your beloved friend. When was the last time you said, Ma, Pa, Pe, Kuya, kumusta na kayo dyan? Sabila, if they ever are. Have you ever spoke to them at all? And you might want to spend some time in prayer talking with them or thanking them. Even if they're alive, even if they can't hear you. Our salvation history is our human history, and it is made up of people with whom Christ shared his saving power. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. So we start talking again.